I just want to say a little bit about our center. CLACS is both an MA program and a designated Title VI National Resource Center funded by the Department of Education of the United States, with a mission to promote an understanding of our region, and that we do through public programming such as tonight's teacher training, as well as teaching less commonly taught languages, which in our case is Quechua and Haitian Creole. For more information, look us up on the web, find us on social media, we're on all platforms. Quick note about tonight, we're live streaming tonight's event on Facebook, so please take a quick second or during the event to find our page and share it with your networks and your friends. Again, we're on social media, so if you're tweeting and you want to follow the conversation, please use the hashtag CLACSEvents2018. I'm really excited to learn about the experience of our filmmakers who are going to be speaking tonight. Just by my own experience growing up in Puerto Rico, it's hard to realize that there is such thing as Puerto Rican cinema, but there is, and there's a very long tradition of Puerto Rican cinema. It's just that, you know, what we get on most theaters is, you know, the Hollywood big feature films with things exploding and all that stuff. But there's great cinema made in Puerto Rico, so I'm really excited to, you know, hear about your experiences, what's going on now, and what's hopefully what's coming up in the future. So it promises to be a really good conversation. So tonight's event is co-sponsored with the King Juan Carlos I of Spain Center, and that's the space where we're sitting, as well as by the Department of Spanish and Portuguese at NYU and Rutgers University. Last but not least, I want to thank our graduate assistants who work the backstage here and make this events possible. Tonight we're inaugurating a new group of graduate students who are working with us. So that's Jessica on the camera, Leo and Gwen, who you probably saw when you came in. And now I'm going to leave you with Jennifer Dupre, who's going to introduce our guests and our moderator for tonight. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. Thanks for being here. I'll be brief. My name is Jennifer Dupre, Associate Professor in the Department of Spanish and Portuguese Studies at Rutgers University, Newark. I am very happy to have this group of great filmmakers with us. We had 2 days of a film festival at Rutgers Newark, Thursday and today during the morning, and then we have this event here, so we've been having such a great time with them. We have here from the film El Chata, we have Sandra Enar, who is the producer of the film, one of the producers of the film. We have Gustavo Ramos Perales, who is the director of El Chata, and Alexon Dupre, who is the lead character of El Chata. We have here another great actor from the film El Chata, Carlos Miranda. From El Silencio del Viento, Álvaro Aponte Centeno, who is the director of El Silencio del Viento. We have Maite Rivera Carbonell, who is the sound designer of El Silencio del Viento, and she's also the producer of El Silencio del Viento, one of the producers. And we have Ari Maniel Cruz, who is the director of Antes que Cante el Gallo, and Kisha Tiquina Burgos, who is one of the actresses of Antes que Cante el Gallo, as well as the screenwriter of Antes que Cante el Gallo. And we have Israel Lugo, who is the lead character of El Silencio del Viento, and he also plays a character in Antes que Cante el Gallo. And we have Jose Eugenio Hernandez with us, who is one of the lead characters as well of Antes que Cante el Gallo. So this is a kind of a feast that we have this evening with them. I'd like to thank, first of all, also to, before beginning the event, Omar, Daujare, I don't know if I'm pronouncing well your last name, for his support and for the enthusiasm to have also this group of filmmakers at NYU. The films were screening Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday at the Cantor Film Center from 6 to 9. And it has been also a success with the students. And I'd also like to thank the Department of Spanish and Portuguese Studies for their support, Licia Fiolmata, of course, for her support, and my colleagues, Lourdes Davila and Anabel Lopez Garcia, who are not here because they have other things to do, other, you know, commitments, for helping me also to organize this event here. I am very, very happy, and I'd like to pass the word to Licia Fiolmata, who is a full professor in the Department of Spanish and Portuguese Studies here at NYU, and she's going to give us the introduction to the event. Thank you, and welcome again.
Thank you, Jennifer. As you can tell, Licia Fiolmata has a little cold, but she's going to try to soldier on. I apologize if I have any problems, but I'm hoping that the spirit of the room is with me, and we can have a smooth entry into what is really the meat, or as the Spaniards say, el plato fuerte, of this event, which is a conversation between our guests tonight and the audience. Jennifer is actually the one who's going to moderate the roundtable. So I'm going to just, Jennifer asked me, well, I'm just going to read very quickly. It is a pleasure to be here this evening. Professor Jennifer Dupre, our event organizer, has asked me to offer a few words of introduction to the three films. First, I would like to start off with my deepest congratulations to the filmmakers, and also the writers, actors, sound technicians, cinematographers, and all the crew members for their terrific work. In music, musicians will always say something sounds good if they are satisfied with a performance or a recording. With these three films, my first reaction was, these are truly films, cinema, movies. They are good. In that full sense of a work that addresses every aspect of its medium. My only regret was not to have been able to see them on a large movie screen. Arimaniel Cruz, Álvaro Aponte Centeno, and Gustavo Ramos Perales, my sincerest thanks for creating these three movies. Antes que cante el gallo, Before the Rooster Crows, El Silencio del Viento, The Silence of the Wind, and El Chata, The Sparring Partner. I believe all the movies are 2017, but Jennifer will correct any mistake that I may make. I just went through my scarce resources, but 2016, 2017. During the discussion that follows, which will be led, as I said, by Professor Dupre, I hope to find out more about how you obtained the funding and talent to carry these films through to fruition. How, indeed, the group was able to carry through on the initial plan or project for your films. I should note that I have already been impressed by other Puerto Rican films of recent issue. Going back a little bit to 2012, and again, my dates are a little bit from memory, a little sketchy, I recall La Aguja, The Needle, by Jose Correa Vigier and Carmen Oquendo. I also think of a movie I haven't seen, but I've heard a lot about, Extraterrestres, by Carla Calvina. And especially two documentaries that I did see this summer while in Puerto Rico, 1950, La Insurrección Nacionalista, de José Manuel Dávila Marichal, and Vietnam, Puerto Rico, Gabriel Miranda. One I haven't seen yet, and actually I should see because I'm an avid sports fan, New Yorican Basket, by Julio Cesar Torres and Ricardo Olivero Lora. Interestingly, these latter three movies were often spoken about as a kind of groundbreaking trilogy. I heard this a lot when I was there. in this case, no, in that case, of documentary film. And of course, tonight we are considering narrative films, fiction films. However, we are encountering them as a kind of groundbreaking trilogy as well. So I just wanted to throw that out there. I also add to this panorama, and a little bit in unwitting response to what Omar just said, the film research and projects I have learned about in the last years, and I must acknowledge that much of this knowledge comes through Professor Lena Burgos Lafuente, who is in the audience today. Recently, I viewed, thanks to Professor Burgos Lafuente, an excellent episode, for example, on the film dubbing industry, which had Puerto Rico as its most important hub during the 1950s and 1970s, en doblaje en Puerto Rico, part of the series Prohibido Olvidar. This title and the intent to rescue Puerto Rican cultural history, to redress through representation, to reach out to multiple audiences through film distribution and viewership, and also the specifics of film aesthetics. All of these, for me, resonate with elements of our three movies under discussion today. And of course, I must add that film aesthetics are heavily, although not exclusively, visual. They are also sonorous, of course, as in the dubbing of movies and many other items that I'll briefly comment and I hope we discuss. Echoing Omar again, and we didn't get together on this, and he's obviously much younger than I am. When I grew up, we were often told in Puerto Rico that making movies was not possible because, one, there was no money, and two, we weren't told this directly in such words, but it was more or less a message. There was little talent or industry. As I did my research on Puerto Rican pop music, I found out about many films that were made in Puerto Rico, in fact. And also, thanks to, again, Professor Burgos Lafuente, about the films of the Divetco. I think in our discussion, it might be interesting to reference the Divetco, no? Since there are echoes of the signal moment in Puerto Rican film production, which was state-sponsored, of course. And here, a few years ago, Professor Burgos organized a screening of these films right here in this room, if I recall correctly, with the discussion, so it's a nice loop. While looking at the end credits for today's movies, I noticed there were multiple sources of funding, including the government of Puerto Rico. I hate to be surprised because I don't expect too much, but there it was. But also other governments or states, which I also was interested in. Through my email, I noticed crowdfunding campaigns to finance some of the costs of these movies. I remember when the first narrative movies that I knew about were released. Jacobo Morales, Dios los cría. I'm dating myself, I know, but. And later, La Gran Fiesta, which were received as the first movies in Puerto Rico. And of course, they were important. I'm not sure if they were the first, but I remember these moments. These were very big events at the time that signaled hope for a Puerto Rican film industry. Here, I think, in the movies that we saw, there, well, I don't know if you saw them, but there is an unstated but very potent film memory, what I like to think of as a film memory, on the one hand, and also a cinematic amplification through the film's creation, no? The way that the films, and I'll speak about this in a second, both reference a Puerto Rican film in a restricted sense, if you will, and but also amplify Puerto Rican film and puts it in the world, which it should have been a while ago. But in this film, it's just unmistakable, that gesture. And also the conversation with films of the world. Possible citations or riffs or a general awareness of a larger film world and a series of kinships with global cinemas that the filmmakers could also tell us about and I'd like to hear about. However, my greatest excitement for this evening is a discussion of, how, as I said before, how the three films really encompass the spectrum of the film medium itself. I don't want to reveal the plot elements or the climaxes of the movies because I'd ruin it for anybody who hadn't seen the movies, no? So I'm not gonna do that. Therefore, I'm not going to analyze various magnificent sequences that are found throughout the three films. And I'm not speaking because I'm trying to be nice to anybody. I actually believe this, okay? For example, two long scenes at the end of Álvaro's film that I found truly stunning. I know some of our students viewed these movies in conjunction with their courses with my colleagues, Professors Lourdes Dávila and Anabel López García. So I don't know if during our discussion spoilers might be revealed. And you may have read Professor Dupre's article that she published in April in 80 Grados about these three movies. And I'm going to take an idea that she said in this article. She mentions, Jennifer, correct me if I'm wrong, please, the films as instances of neorealismo, new realism, no? What scholars of films, including a couple of my colleagues here in this university, but many others, and in fact, I think one of our Puerto Rican colleagues, Professor Juan Carlos Rodriguez, I think, is also working on this or has published on this, professor at Georgia Tech, the creation of reality effects, or sometimes called the return of the real, new realism, etc. Also an issue that I think would be great to discuss with the creators of these films. Where does this realism come from? And by this I don't necessarily mean the situation of Puerto Rico, although that's also part of the film experience, no doubt, but the representation, you know, of experience. How is it directly related to depictions of rural life? The return to the rural is prominent in all three movies. One thing that I like, and this is an aside, is that there is a way to see them in as a kind of a statement of sorts that there still is rural life in Puerto Rico, no? Because we've been told over and over that's gone, el campo, it's just one big suburb. I personally don't know much about rural life myself, but I thought, well, this is interesting. Maybe there is a rural life that doesn't get represented that is, in fact, rural. Anyways, we could talk about that. This return to rurality is found in Latin American cinema as well, at large, and also in fiction. There is a whole new strand of criticism, perhaps, I'm not sure how new it is, but it's recent, related to the new regionalisms, to new landscapes, and to the post-natural landscape, which I feel is a good way of approaching the three movies under discussion. I mentioned the Divetco, of course, and the film vocabulary we view in these films might be related to that historical archive, as much as to contemporary creations. Divetco movies were often set in rural Puerto Rico, and their aim was explicitly pedagogical, yet many included avant-garde aspects, not just the shooting, but also the music of the Divetco. These three films don't foreground their locations in the literal sense of celebrating or naming, but they make very good use of it, the places. Now there's a singularity and a multiplicity to this rurality, a naming, and also sometimes, unless you know where they are, because you happen to know, it's not really marked. But they make very good use of the places in which they were shot. Antes que cante el gallo does mention Barranquitas. Some of us can recognize La Trompeta en Coupé en El Chata. And Crash Boat, I think Crash Boat is in Aguada, but here I am. I don't remember. Aguadilla, ay Dios mío. I knew I was going to make a mistake. Shame on me. Anyway, in Aguadilla, in the coast, no? In El Silencio del Viento. Those who are not familiar with these places can get the information from the film credits, right? So one thing is my memory or my impression, and also the information I get from the film credits. The filming of these locations in all three films is simply wonderful, at least in this viewer's opinion. Characters moving through platanales, lomas, and the winding up and down streets of the town in Antes que Cante el Gallo. The shots of the shack, the tin rooftops, The boxing gym and the makeshift ring in El Chata are set against the beautiful panoramas of El Lago Las Curias. Las Curias or Las Curias?
Yes.
Oh my God, I'm just making mistakes, but I remember the lake. And environs or landscapes that are made related to that man-made hole in the middle of the lake that is really spectacular if you see it. And it's spectacularly shot in the film. And the open ocean, the beaches, and countryside in the northern tip of the island are all heavily featured in El Silencio del Viento, of course. Along with realist mise-en-scenes of homes, yards, shops, cafeterias, bars, streets, and other such local, sometimes outdoors and sometimes indoors locations. San Juan is not at the center of any of these movies. Here, I would tentatively think of the three films as working from a new landscape or a new regionalism. Riffing on what you said about neorealism, Jennifer. All those familiar with Puerto Rican studies know the trope of insularism, extending to other islands as well across the globe, and the construction of the ocean as a trap or delimitation. Recent studies on archipelagic oceanic work and the oceanic work with the submerged, with the ocean as a connector, with islands as more linked by global flows than by the nation state. No? These views have altered our modes of thought, and these treatments of the island landscape and the tropes of its representation in these movies, I feel, reflect these new approaches, whether consciously or not. I think of queer regionalist studies like Jack Halberstam's In a Queer Time and Place, or the forthcoming Gayatri Gopinath book, Unruly Visions. Halberstam speaks of a metronormative narrative that consistently portrays rural life as unfit, in that case, for queer people. But I think that idea of temporality and that metronormative temporality superimposed on the movie is interesting. And there's definitely a lot of characters that seem out of sync or out of joint with the rurality that the movies allude to. Gayatri Gopinath develops the idea of metronormative time to query national film's recourse to the metronormative narrative as a translation of regionalism for the world. I think this is also interesting because my impression from the films was that they were really for the world. No? And but at the same time, the regionalism can be completely particular. Something like that, which of course I'm just throwing out there for the discussion. These are ideas that came to my mind, although I have not developed an analysis of either one of these three movies. But in their recourse to rurality or rural life, their decentering of the capital city, San Juan, and the dominant temporal narrative of developmentalism, Biela, progress, etc., they are simultaneously contemporary and archaic, or anachronistic. And that's not a bad word for me. That's a good thing. No? Something we could profitably discuss. There is definitely an impulse, no? Very 21st century, but also archaizing or anachronistic in the movies. They are of their time, the 21st century, in terms of what they depict so tremendously, in my opinion, and in their total form, knowledge of film form in all of its expressions. All of our movies, for example, allude to global flows. Antes que cante el gallo starts with the mother's last visit to the daughter, which I have to say, I think the actress that portrays the daughter is great. Miranda Purcell. All of the acting in these movies is fantastic. I was really taken by this young actress. The mother, just before she migrates to Florida. In El Chata, the family, which visually has a lot in common with some Divetco characters, if you've seen those movies, are trying to save up money to be able to migrate to the States. I can't recall if it's New York City or somewhere else. Okay, it's not said. That's what, good, I couldn't recall. Help me out. El Silencio del Viento deals directly with the human trafficking of migrants, which the movie represents as bodies without translation in various interesting ways.
I noticed, for example, that I don't know if it was on purpose, or, but I mean, I'm here to find out too. No subtitling at some moments. Also, the main character sometimes directly is talking in conversations that go nowhere because they don't understand each other and they're speaking different languages, etc. So, El Silencio del Viento directly deals with the flows between the Dominican Republic and Puerto Rico, specifically that part of Puerto Rico, that region, the northern tip, eastern, northeastern tip of Puerto Rico. Oh my God, northwestern. Well, I'm glad I'm not a professor of geography. Northwestern. I can get there by if I drive a car. The landscape, it may seem obvious, is not treated with imperial or tourist tropes of Puerto Rico and the Caribbean. Islands as paradise for consumption, etc. However, I was really struck at how the filmmakers took advantage of the landscape. It's really beautiful. The blues, the greens, the shades, the colors, the lines created by the, I'm just going to say natural, but maybe it's not natural, but the forms, no, in the landscape, while creating a defamiliarized landscape. Even if you know where they are, it's still the effect is of defamiliarization. However, they still recreated a sense of the sublime that fit the movies, their movies' needs perfectly. Even though we're talking about movies that are obviously different in tone when you see them, no? Antes que cante el gallo, for example, is a coming-of-age story. It's different in tone from the other two. The climaxes and all are tough, but naturally they're different. And now I'm just going to end with a couple things and pass it over to the filmmakers. Things that I thought were interesting. The portrayal of a failed, deficient, distressed, and excessive masculinity. And by excessive, I don't mean just good excessive, but also bad excessive. Both are contained in some of these movies. The three films have it in common. I have to confess, I spent multiple scenes in Antes que Cante el Gallo in suspense, cringing, because the scenes between the daughter, who is on the verge of pubescence and sexual awakening, understood through the arrival of her father from prison, were so well done, towing a very delicate line of representation that really evoked warring interpretations of those gazes exchanged between father and daughter, and the inability to establish conclusively the meaning of the gazing. Again, it is so well done, and the sexuality is captured throughout the film without interruptions of a moralistic kind. It really speaks to the adolescent as a figure, and particularly the female adolescent as a frontier. There are many elements of no. How the security state appears, for example, prison, police, Coast Guard, immigration, incarceration, etc. The security state is part of the plot of the three films that together tell a vastly different story about Puerto Rico and islands. Colonies or former colonies than what still passes as the Puerto Rican story globally, even among the so-called general educated viewership. The sound, I have to say, big, big shout out to all the people who worked with the sound in the movies. Some of the movies reminded me of Lucrecia Martel's work with sound, particularly La Cienega, that masterwork. And I say, no, the coloring in some of the shots of landscape also reminded me of that treatment of the landscape, no? So the colors were also really good. Sound editing, the multiplicity of sounds from music to sheet music and jazz or classical to pop tracks, conversations, countrysides, ambient noise. The coquis also make an appearance. The use of silence is also part of the sonic register. No? All in all, the soundtracks are excellent, both in the music that was composed for some of these films and also the creation of the sonic atmosphere. Some feature tracks from today's pop and are completely 21st century in that sense. Others have music that is composed for the movie and more reminiscent of the classic music soundtrack. El Chata, El Silencio del Viento, for example. I can't say all good things, right? So to end, I have to say something I didn't like. The actress, Kairiana Núñez, character. Well, I can't reveal the plot of the story. I just wanted to say that I believe she is a true talent, and I would love to see her more in movies. And I'm kidding, I'm not going to go through all the criticisms of the movie at all. I do think there are some interesting dissonances, or that the movies work with dissonances, and that I hope we can cover. For me, for example, the publicity materials. The poster for Antes que cante el gallo did not prepare me for the movie that I was going to see at all. I thought it was completely different just from looking at the poster. I'm not certain if this was due to my sensibilities or on purpose. The title of El Silencio del Viento was also a puzzle to me, and it also pointed me in a direction that was completely different from the movie that I saw. I don't know, again, if it was just my own subjective reaction or on purpose. The poster for El Chata also threw me off a bit, as it seemed centered on the boy, but the movie is centered on the father, wonderfully played. ¿Cómo te llamas tú? Perdóname. Alexis, Alexon, Alexon. I know I should have brought the film details. Alexon?
Alexon Dupre.
Alexon Dupre. He's the main character in El Chata, this actor. It threw me off a bit because the poster is centered on the boy, but it's actually the movie is about the father, no? Especially about his already dilapidated body, his 30-something male body, which has not only sustained the pounding of boxing, but also a prison sentence, and the more symbolic dilapidation of his own psychic structure and his extended kinship ties. The poster from El Silencio del Viento, after viewing the movie, I could tell it's taken from a terrific sequence, beautifully done, beautifully composed as well as shot, disorienting and defamiliarizing, as I said. I don't want to give anything away, but I was interested in these hints of dissonance. And if you see the movie, or if you've already seen the movie, you have many more examples of that. I am delighted that I was able to view these three films for this event. I wish them wide distribution and viewership. And I'm really looking forward to the discussion among the filmmakers, the actors, the cast, the crew, and Jennifer this evening. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Licia. That was an incredible introduction. I really enjoyed it. Thank you so much. I think that we can pass to the Q&A part of the event. And I'm going to start with one question to, like, romper el hielo. And then I pass the ball to you. I really liked what you said about the defamiliarization aspect of some of the films. And one of the films that, in my mind, when I saw it, has that aspect of defamiliarization in a very powerful way is Antes que cante el gallo. For instance, the scenes of the platanal and the religious rituals at the platanal. In the article I wrote for 80 grados, I call it grotesque, but I think that your word really conveys that what is happening there, defamiliarization. So I'd like to ask Ari Maniel and Kicha, who are, you know, the director and the screenwriter, to talk to me a little bit about that. If you believe that there is an aspect of defamiliarization in those scenes, in the sense that we have the religious rituals, and then you have also the blind girl that goes to have sex with the sort of priest that is in the platanal, and the whole atmosphere is a little bit indeed defamiliarized. So if you want to talk a little bit about that.
Muy buenas noches. Good night to everyone. My name is Ari Maniel Cruz. I am the director and producer of Antes que cante el gallo, or Before the Rooster Crows. And I will answer that question with another question, so I can actually answer properly. I have to start begging your forgive me, but I don't understand the word defamiliarization. To tell you the truth, I really don't, I cannot answer. I need help if anybody can explain. Not, actually, I really not familiar with the term defamiliarization.
Defamiliarization? Well, I don't know if you want to talk a little bit in the way that you try to convey it here, or, well.
Sí, es que no conozco la palabra,
perdón. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. That you have the something that is so familiar and in a way kind of, you know, beautiful, okay. And a little bit of paradisiac, like a platanán.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But then all that happens there is
whoa. Yeah, yeah, yeah. See, I think that is the result of quizás maybe our position towards religion, or at least the position I have towards the religious aspects of the film. For me, always I was trying to portray more the cultural aspects of the religion more than the actual faith. And very specifically, we're talking about the apparition of the Virgin. The Virgin apparitions are not endorsed by the church. So for us, it was actually an act of revolution to be celebrating something that is not endorsed by the institution. Is a revolutionary act inside their reality. So for me, it was very interesting to portray it also as a scheme of creating a social environment for our community. It was not only the apparition of the Virgin, but it's also a social point, a place where people get together and share things. That's why we created some scenes, some very important scenes that happen in the Platanal, because for me, it's not only a La aparición de la Virgen, is where people go to meet each other, is where people go, and even they, in our case, we choose to create a lie and to create a social aspect and political and life around a lie that we all share. Mm-hmm. But it's our lie, and it's our revolution against a cultural institution that we call church, or we can call it tradition, mm-hmm. especially in the countryside, not far from the urban spots like Ponce, Mayagüez, Puerto San Juan, or Mayagüez. Well, it's more common to have other situations. Like, for example, for me, was more important the thing that the blind girl was having an affair with an older man, and she was saying that you have to take care of your body. For me, that was more important than the actual Virgin. Was the hypocrisy of people that was portrayed to that sexual relationship of the blonde girl and the old guy was more important in the Platanal. That the actual event of the apparition of the Virgin. So for me, it's always, I'm trying always to understand it more than to express it through the process of doing it. And in that process of understanding, I just was trying to have a political position towards it. I will explain around with humor also in those scenes. There's a lot of my kind of humor into those scenes, and it took off from there. And of course, as I said earlier today, I think, what was the term again? The familiarization, that could be Akisha's anthology when she ends it, because her work puts you in that position a lot. She deals with those things. So it's Akisha's work, it's her writing will take you there. So it has to do a lot with Akisha's writing.
I just wanted to add that El Platanal is where actually that happens. I grew up in a small town in Puerto Rico, in the center of the island, Barranquitas, where I grew up going to these apparitions in different platanales, in different mountains, in outdoors places where people go to pray and to expect this apparition, to ask for miracles. I grew up doing that in a platanal, so that's why, mainly why we is in a platanal, because in the script it was a platanal, no doubt about it. I wanted to say something curious. Antes que cante el gallo was born in this university. I started creating and writing the script here in 2007.
And it's and the professor mentioned that maybe, I think it was in 2011 that they had the Divetco Festival. We were here for that event that you mentioned in your speech, when they brought the Divetco films, and we were creating Antes que Cante el Gallo in that moment. So la Divetco and the el expresionismo que that we can see in Amilcar Tirado has a lot to do with this film. Actually, when we were creating, choosing the locations, we revisited some of the movies. There's one very specific that I really like that I feel has a very Russian cinema approach into the editing, and it's El Milagro en la Montaña by Amilcar Tirado. I think that's the title of the film, that Jesus appears to the jíbaros. The montage in that film and the images that he created were very, very important for us. And I took El Puente also, but actually there was, by the time that we were pre-producing the movie, in Museo de Arte de Ponce had an exhibition on the images from Jack Delano. So the crew, we all went down there, and 45 minutes from San Juan, but I said, we went down there, so far away. And we saw it, and we discussed it, and we created the images and the ambience from that, from there. So it has to do a lot with the movie, yes.
Okay.
Yes, you do.
My name is Luis Cristian. I'm actually the producer of the Puerto Rican International Puerto Rican Heritage Film Festival that we actually do here at NYU.
We met before.
My friend, ¿cómo estás? And I'm glad to announce that El Chata is going to be part of our festival this year.
Yeah.
My question, I'll do it in Spanish and in English. So there's been a lot of talk about what happened at the Toronto Film Festival about Driven. I don't know if you've heard.
We're going there now.
Okay. Driven is a film that was actually done by an English company, English cast and directors in Puerto Rico, right after the hurricane hit, and it's being now taunted as the Puerto Rican entry for the Oscars. That's the rumor within, because I'm a producer also. My question to you, la pregunta para ustedes, is how does filmmaking on the island differentiate between being a filmmaker from the island from filmmakers that are outside of the island? Because I've done both films here and there, but since you're there all the time, I'll be there next year all the time, but how does it affect you knowing that there's like a double standard when it comes to film festivals about our work?
Well, there's a double standard about ourselves inside each one of us. So that's very Puerto Rican to start with. But I have to say, let's talk about, you brought it up. Okay. This has nothing to do with our work, but it has to do with it's everything. It's everything for us. Because let's understand something. We cannot be candidates for the Oscars. So that's not true, because Puerto Rico is banned from the Oscars. So as the foreign language film category. Okay, why that movie can compete? Because it's in English. That's why it can compete. It won't compete in the foreign language. It will compete in the rest of the categories of the Oscars. So I hope they win. I have a lot of friends who worked in that movie. I hope they win the Oscar. It will be a great party for us. It will be big for the Puerto Rican service cinematic industry. Not the Puerto Rican industry of cinema. The cinema service.
Different.
You do service, you know. I can serve you your drinks, your food. I can drive your cars. I can be an extra. Maybe I get a one line as an actor, and me as a director, maybe I get to be the second AD of the third unit, and I have to have my rate because we are so fortunate that they can come and pay us less, but they get 50% credit deduction. And they're already rich, so we're making richer. We're giving. You know, rich people are getting richer with us, while we get poorer. But we are so fortunate that they are coming to bring jobs to our country, and we need jobs. And the governor can take a picture with those actors. We are so fortunate for all of that. But if you want to talk about Puerto Rican cinema, it's something to this right here, you know. But how that affects us? Well, it doesn't affect us directly. What does affect us is that people don't understand the difference between Puerto Rican industry and the Puerto Rican service industry. And we are very proud to have great technicians that will give A-class service to anybody who wants to come and bring their money. We are great doing our job. But the Puerto Rican government and the Puerto Rican people have to understand the difference between those two things. Because our work is based on creating an industry that we don't have. And if we want to have it, we need every piece of incentive, either credits or funds, or even to be kind enough to come to our premiere. As a governor, for example, if the Rolling Stones come in, they will go meet Mick Jagger, but they won't go to our premieres or to Rosa Luisa's play. They won't.
I don't want them.
No, we don't want them, but we want them to want to come. We want them to want to come. We want them at the opening night of the San Juan Film Festival. We want to have a San Juan Film Festival, you know. We want to have an international theater, and we want to say, no, you cannot come, but we don't have a festival. So that's what I'm saying. That's the problem. The problem is that they are walking on the red carpet of Venice with the Puerto Rican flag, and it's not our films who are screening there, you know? But I hope they win the Oscar. I do hope, because there's great people there working, and they're great friends, you know? They won't.
On what technicality have they been?
I don't want to say it.
Say it.
The same group of colleagues of ours who are mostly doing these services started doing Puerto Rican films in English, and they were submitted as Puerto Rican films for the foreign language film, so we got banned from the foreign language film because we speak English. So then we said, no, it was a mistake. Academy, please. And Jacobo Morales went there, and we wrote letters, and we've done everything since. And they said, no. But you know, it's OK. You know, it's OK. Let's make films. Awards is something that we don't do. We do films. Let's make films. And if they invite us, we go. If they don't invite us, it's OK. We want to make movies, you know? Yeah. Los Angeles is very expensive, so we might as well don't go. That's true.
You're not invited.
There you go.
So I'd like to know if people from the audience have questions about the other films and to the other directors and actors. And yes. Go ahead.
I think Keisha talked a little bit about. Hi, Keisha. The origin of Cuando Canta el Gallo, but I would like to hear from each of the directors where these ideas came from, because there's such interesting stories. And by the way, I'd like to congratulate all of you, actors, directors, crew. You've done an amazing job. I've seen these films. They're universal stories. They should be seen everywhere around the world, and you're actually continuing to articulate what our identity as Puerto Ricans is in film. And that's really important, because for many, many years there was just a few films here and there, but I see an explosion of films that are re-articulating our identity, which is really great. Mm-hmm. So congratulations.
Thank you so much.
Hello, good night. I'm Gustavo Ramos. I'm going to speak Spanish because it's my language and I express myself better in Spanish, so I'd rather speak Spanish. Bueno, el chata. Cambié la tonalidad.
Vamos a doblarte.
El chata. El chata viene un poco de mi vuelta a Puerto Rico. Yo estaba estudiando en Madrid, estaba haciendo mi máster en cine, y cuando regresé, no habían pasado muchos años, habían pasado 4 años, y no sé, parecería que hubiesen pasado como 15 o 10, era como otro país mucho más violento, por lo menos así lo sentía yo. No sé si en la realidad era así, era una percepción mía, que venía de vivir en Madrid y no se escuchaban disparos, ni ambulancias, ni ninguna de esas cosas. Entonces, la primera noche que llegamos, junto con Sandra, que es mi esposa y también la productora de la película, estábamos acostados tipo 11 de la noche y escuchamos en el patio atrás de nuestra casa que un niño le grita: no mates a mi papá, no mates a mi papá, no mates a mi papá, pum pum pum, no lo mates, pum pum pum. Yo caí en la cama sentado, la española casi se muere de un ataque al corazón, y yo me asomé, yo miré por la ventana, yo no sé, yo estaba azorado, yo pensé que era que había pasado, y a nadie le importó. Nadie prendió la luz, nadie llamó a la policía, y yo dije: esto está mal, nos estamos acostumbrando a esto. Wow. Nos acostumbramos a que un niño grite: no mates a mi papá, y nadie prenda la luz y mire a ver si ese niño está bien, porque no nos importa. Al otro día, lo gracioso es que se lo cuento a un amigo, y mi amigo está fumando un cigarrillo y me dice: tranquilo, ya te vas a acostumbrar de nuevo. Y efectivamente me acostumbré de nuevo. En ese camino fui descubriendo de que yo vivía en un país que no me gustaba y que me sentía preso, y que empecé a tener un montón de conflictos con él porque venía de otro país, y me empecé a enfrentar un montón de miedo, y el país, la situación, mi situación personal, los crímenes y mi afición al boxeo se juntan y sale chata. Literalmente.
Ramón te atiende.
Sí. Así que...
Pero
ya,
no
sabemos
si todo el mundo
sabe
hablar español.
Álvaro.
¿Alguien needs translation?
Álvaro. Me toca. Señoras y señores, Álvaro Ponte Centeno. Álvaro Ponte
Centeno. El chico de la chaqueta rosa. De la chamarra rosa.
Que como nació.
Que como la idea. Ya.
Traté de escapar.
No se escapa, no puede.
¿Cómo la idea, no? ¿Cómo llega la idea? ¿En español, bla?
No sé, sí. ¿Inglés?
Yeah, un mix. Que me salga. Spanglish, yeah. I remember when I was in Cannes.
Inside joke. But you got it.
I was in that festival with my second chirping. Before, Maite, my friends, told me, you need to think in a new story, new idea, but for a long metrage, feature film. And I was thinking in that story, in the immigration between Dominican Republic and Puerto Rico. And when I land in Puerto Rico before the festival, I start to do a lot of interview with Dominicans in Rio Piedra, in Puerto Rico, and also in people in the coast of the west coast and the north coast. And after that, I just, how do you say, cosí? Yeah, put together all these stories and create that script. But then I just put my personal a little bit my personal experience, my personal life, like the grandmother and the relationship between the fathers and the daughter. The movie was shot in my grandmother's house in Aguadilla. the river is was a place that I was sharing a lot with my tío and mis primos fishing. And I grew up with reggaeton too when I was when cuando era underground. This is the reason why the popular party in English. El party de Marquesina que estaba encendido ahí con reggaetón y perreo. And that's it in general, no? In general. And the movie told about about different things. One is the exterior, is about the immigration, but the in the interior way is about the lost and el luto. No?
Mourning.
Yeah, el luto. que tiene el personaje principal con su hermana, no? Un poco en general. The scenes about the murder, I found that because one of the first fisherman I was entrevistando, le habían matado a su hermana hacía un mes, dos meses, y eso me llegó bastante profundo. Y in that moment, I decided to put that part of the real story in this story and talk about the violence contra la mujer in Puerto Rico, because it's a huge problem. And this is in general.
Buenas noches, yo lo voy a decir primero en español y lo voy a traducir después al inglés. Para eso traje a mi traductora, Jennifer Dupré. Bueno, tú dices la creación de los personajes, ¿verdad? Okay. Básicamente, trataba yo de presentar en la pantalla lo que era un pescador del área de Aguadilla. Lo relacionaba, estaba familiarizado porque pues, vengo también de la costa, pero del sur oeste, Aguadilla queda al noroeste. Y bueno, la tarea era tratar de representar físicamente y gestualmente y también con el lenguaje a una persona de esa zona. Porque el trabajo de Álvaro se destaca porque es muy realista. La selección de los espacios, de la manera en que es su narrativa. Entonces yo tenía que pasar desapercibido, ¿no? O sea, más bien que ser parte de esa realidad. O sea, que pasar desapercibido me refiero al actor, que el actor no se viera, sino que se viera un personaje real. Y para eso estuve en un proceso de observación. Me mudé como un mes antes de rodar la película para entonces buscar la creación y hacer el diseño de lo que era el personaje. Y luego, pues, ya una vez está, ¿verdad?, la construcción de cómo se proyecta, pues viene todo el aspecto que ya he trabajado, ya he venido trabajando con el director desde el guión, sobre todo el aspecto del universo emocional del personaje, que en la película tiene una parte muy importante. Es la situación de la hermana, ¿verdad? La muerte de la hermana, lo que mueve al personaje hacia adelante. Adelante. ¿Alguien necesita traducción? Estamos bien.
Bueno, para el Chata es un personaje que Gustavo pone en unas situaciones bien difíciles. Había muchas maneras de interpretar un boxeador, pero la manera que se escogiera necesitaba mucha justicia, porque las situaciones a las que me voy a enfrentar en la película no son situaciones fáciles de entender ni para nada cotidianas, aunque, o sea, suceden mucho, pero son muy intensas. Entonces son situaciones que te cambian la vida, por ende la reacción a esas situaciones era importante. Lo más importante para mí como actor era la justicia al personaje. Por lo tanto, lo que hice fue que me adentré al mismo barrio donde grabamos, a Las Curías, y estuve por 2 años básicamente compartiendo unas 4 o 5 horas al día con diferentes boxeadores, desde chatas profesionales, desde antiguos chatas, antiguos campeones de boxeo, prospectos del boxeo. Y fuimos un poco pues explorando ese mundo desde adentro, y escogiendo características de los personajes, hasta el punto que llegamos básicamente a tener 2 personas que eran, son 50 y 50 del personaje, ¿no? En cuanto a 100%, incluso las situaciones que ya estaban en el libreto, ellos las habían vivido. Y pues siempre la idea de Gustavo fue comprenderlo lo más posible y que lo viéramos, ¿no? Hacerlo lo más real, tratar de sacar detalles. Y lo trabajamos por 2 años en el barrio, entrenando. Yo tuve una transformación bien grande. Yo estuve por 2 años haciendo 7 horas de ejercicio diaria. Cambié toda mi dieta, boxeé, conocí presos. Nosotros grabamos en la cárcel con presos. Grabamos en los rines de boxeo con boxeadores, en los puntos de droga con narcotraficantes, y pues todo se tenía que hacer con mucho respeto, ¿no? No podía aparecer mi primera vez allí para nada. Así que yo pues por 2 años entré en estos mundos y me gané su respeto al fin y al cabo, porque al principio nadie me quería por allí, y luego pues fueron acogiéndome, y hoy por hoy son amigos. Vimos cosas macabras y cosas hermosas, unión familiar y desunión familiar en todos los sentidos, y bueno, una experiencia de verdad, un proceso bien intenso de conocimiento como antropológico. Eso.
Bueno. Buenas tardes, Carlos Miranda. Al igual que Gustavo, y verdad, las energías, las musas se encuentran, ¿verdad? Las cosas se encuentran. Cuando Gustavo me llamó para el personaje, me hizo mucha gracia, porque al igual que él, yo crezco en mi comunidad, son unas parcelas. Entre los 8 años hasta mi adultez, pues yo estuve en unas parcelas hasta el otro día. Y en mi comunidad, es una comunidad de mucha gente que boxea. No hay un gimnasio de boxeo en mi comunidad, pero mi padrastro, que siempre hago esta aclaración, es mi papá, porque es mi papá, pues era boxeador de joven. Antes de haberse juntado a mi mamá, fue boxeador. Y él es fanático del boxeo, y él se sentaba a ver, y él guardaba los cortes de periódico, y él te cuenta la historia, y él tiene los récords, sabía los récords de todos los boxeadores puertorriqueños. Tenía amistad con muchos boxeadores, conocí muchos boxeadores de niños, boxeadores que luego vi ser campeones. Vi, creo que de muchos de ellos, de aquel gimnasio que recuerdo, ya no están vivos, por las calles, por las balas perdidas y por otras dirigidas, por las vidas que escogieron, por la forma en que se destruyeron la vida y la salud, por la forma en que después también fueron rechazados y terminaron siendo obreros o algunos adictos, como presentan la película. Recuerdo un chamaco boxeador que prometedor, muy prometedor, que terminó, bueno, haciendo drogas y robando y haciendo 20 barbaridades. Nada. ¿Cómo se construye el personaje? Pues yo lo he construido de muchos recuerdos, de muchos recuerdos, de muchos recuerdos. Yo tengo una mochila como el sombrero del mago que no tiene fondo, y tantos esos recuerdos ahí desde que a veces no me acuerdo, y a veces encuentro un libreto y aquello de lo que no me acordaba porque no lo necesito hace mucho tiempo, vuelve y dice, caramba, esto le viste a este tipo. Yo tenía una visión de un personaje un poco más desordenado, y eso fue una de las, yo creo que esa fue la única diferencia que tuvimos en toda la película. Y Gustavo me dijo algo que me marcó de forma particular, porque entonces también me hizo pensar en mi padre natural, biológico. Él decía, este tipo se afeita aunque no lo necesite. Y era como que, ok, este es un pobre orgullosito, este es un pobre planchadito. Este hombre es muy, 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 muy pobre, muy pobre. Este tipo, como mi papá, se acuesta a las 6 de la tarde y se levanta a las 3 de la mañana a caminar por la casa. Y probablemente se hierve una pianda a las 3 de la mañana, porque pues, es un tipo solo. Y se sienta solo, son sus mismos lugares, un tipo de rutinas. Las rutinas son idénticas, su cigarro, su caminada con su perro, chequear su gimnasio, que no sé qué le van a robar, pero bueno. Y todas estas cosas empiezan a ocurrir como ocurrían en mis calles, en las calles de mi parcela. Y los nenes en bicicleta, y el punto donde los tipos bregan bien, pero el otro donde no bregan bien, donde no cruces por ahí, y mi cruzar por 7 residenciales hasta mi escuela, caminando 45 minutos hasta la escuela, a los 8 o 9 años, viniendo de una urbanización de clase media baja, pero donde era otro sistema, y entonces teniendo que adaptarme ahora al barrio sin los recursos. Cogí muchas pescosas, muchas. Por eso le doy tan duro a este muchacho cuando devolverle a alguien algo. Nada, es un tipo de verdad, es un tipo que recuerdo de muchas personas, es una construcción de muchas personas en realidad. Y está dedicado a mi papá, y es un poquito, no es un copycat de mi papá tampoco, nada que ver. Yo es más rudo que mi papá es más dulce. Yo es seco, ama, pero es seco. Y es hermoso, yo es hermoso porque me acordé de muchos maestros. Yo es en Mr. Miyagi puertorriqueño, en verdad. Y fue bien gracioso cuando lo pensé. Un día lo pensé, nunca te lo dije, pero un día lo pensé de ese modo. Y este comentario es tan estúpido, pero bueno, aquí funcionó. Sí, aquí en Enguayo, ¿verdad? De todos los lugares. Está bien, por lo menos no pedí traducción. Entonces, me enamoré de Joe. Y lo más maravilloso cuando encontré a Joe fue tener un guión tan chévere en mis manos. ¿Recuerdan los 80 cuando hacíamos novelas? En Puerto Rico se había hacía muchas novelas, y era tan imposible decir aquellas cosas que nos daban en las manos. Y pues nada, nuestra profesión, nuestro oficio, es un oficio, es el oficio donde tú estudias muchos años para que cuando hagas aquello que te preparaste durante muchos años, no se note la preparación de muchos años. Hay que desaparecer, como decía Alexson también, como estaba compartiendo mi hermano aquí. Así que pues, eso.
Bueno, tuve la suerte de ser el último contestando la pregunta. Y la verdad es que yo iba a hablar de la inmersión hasta que escuché a Alexson, que estuvo dos años ahí y ya no me atrevo a hablar de inmersión. Básicamente, yo lo que hice fue una mini inmersión. Con algunos meses, ¿verdad? 2-3 meses antes de empezar a rodar, que todavía no sabía que iba a ser el personaje, pues empecé a visitar más frecuentemente a Barranquitas, ¿no? Donde se desarrolla la película, sobre todo para observar, que es lo básico como actor, escuchar cómo hablan los hombres en Barranquitas, escuchar cómo arrastran las R's, escuchar cuál es la musicalidad, ¿no? También del acento, porque a pesar de que Puerto Rico es microscópico, increíblemente hay diferentes acentos. Y ya luego de eso, básicamente fue diseñar el físico del personaje. Otro corte de pelo, otro estilo de los pocos pelos que tengo en la cara. Y ya para una tercera fase, tal vez, hablar directamente con el director, a ver cómo él quiere que este personaje se desenvuelva, cuál sería la gestualidad del personaje. Sí, la gestualidad. Y ya ahí pues me di cuenta que definitivamente el director no estaba pensando en el cliché del presidiario que sale lleno de tatuajes, ¿no? Eso no era lo que él tenía en mente, sino todo lo contrario, un personaje bastante clean cut, que le gustaba verse bien, que le gustaba vestirse bien y que era estilista. Así que pues eso me ayudó también a poderle encontrar otra profundidad al personaje y escapar de lo fácil, del cliché. ¿Tú tuviste un personaje?
Bueno, mi proceso es diferente porque pues en el caso de Antes que cante el gallo, yo lo escribí y obviamente también en colaboración, nuestro trabajo es en equipo. Y ya yo venía delineando ese personaje ya desde la escritura. Claro, yo actúo y trabajo con otras producciones y en otros proyectos, pero siempre la experiencia es que cuando tengo que encarnar un personaje que yo escribo se me hace muy difícil. Se me hace mucho más difícil porque no me puedo distanciar tanto. Y a veces es muy saludable distanciarse y poder entrar en esos zapatos desde algo más fresco. Cuando te sientas a escribirlo, pues ya le ves tantas y tantas cosas que a veces es difícil escoger por dónde le vas a entrar a la cosa. Recuerdo cuando hicimos Under My Nails, que fue una película anterior a esta, recuerdo como hoy, cuando me tocó hacer una de las escenas más difíciles, que le dije a Ari, la verdad es que el papel lo aguanta todo. Pero chapó a los actores que tienen que meterse en estos personajes tan intensos en momentos peak de la vida y sacarlo ahí con toda la honestidad y de dónde, o sea, yo me recuerdo que fue de esos días de grabación en que todo está muy muy caldeado, así como muy emocional, y recordé eso, que primero soy actriz, ¿no? Y entonces yo entro a escribir primero era actriz, entonces cuando uno escribe, uno se olvida que después eso lo tiene que representar un actor. ¡Wow! O sea, es muy, muy, muy intenso. Para el personaje de Antes que cante el gallo, que es la madre, yo lo tenía bastante claro, o sea, y ese es uno de los personajes para mí más importantes de la película y la escena final de ella, cuando se logró, que gracias a este caballero se logró como yo la imaginé en un momento dado, y yo creo que hasta mejor, porque eso es la maravilla del cine, que uno lo visualiza todo, lo ve todo, y luego se desarrolla de una forma que ya se te va de las manos, pero a veces es milagroso, es como mucho más brillante de lo que uno lo imaginó. Y recuerdo que cuando lo logramos, que yo siento que la logramos, yo dije, bueno, ya, no importa cómo termina esta película, no importa que se hayan ido este personaje o el otro, tal escena no la logramos, porque esa para mí es la película, esa escena. Así que, la escena cuando la madre se va. Que ahí empieza todo el journey del personaje, uh-huh. Desde el abandono. Entonces, ya estaba feliz. Eso.
Ahí estaba el nombre.
Elga, I think we have one here and another one.
Elga.
Como quiera.
No, pero
estamos en español. Yo no iba a hacer ninguna pregunta porque no he visto las películas, desafortunadamente. Pero
¿quién ha visto las películas?
¿Hay alguien que ha visto las películas?
Mira.
Pues queremos
A mí no me molestan los chotas, así que si tienen que, o sea, si dicen algo no me molesta, pero cuando Alexon mencionó lo de que al principio llegaste a esas áreas y fuiste rechazado y que después de 2 años de inmersión, ¿verdad? Ya te aceptaron, me entró la curiosidad de saber si la película la vieron. Y después de ahí pensé igual si se vio en Barranquita uh-huh. y si tanto la República Dominicana o la comunidad dominicana puertorriqueña la han visto. Así que básicamente la recepción sí ha habido de las películas de lo que trata.
Bueno, la pregunta no es para mí, pero un pequeño detalle rápido. Todas las casas que se usaron en el Chata, todas desaparecieron después de María.
Wow.
Y una persona me escribió en Facebook y dice, cuando tengas la película en DVD o en Blu-ray, me la envías porque es el último recuerdo de mi casa. Así que nada, lo cuento porque es curioso que me escriban señoras que mucha gente no la ha visto porque la mayoría de esa gente se ha ido. Vive aquí en Nueva York o vive en Kissimmee o vive en Florida. O sea que espero que cuando la saque en DVD poder enviársela para que la vean.
Yo estoy seguro que el Chata no la ha visto. Javier, el personaje que es el Chata, no creo que la haya visto. No creo que él sea ese tipo de persona. Por eso lo escogimos. Uh-huh. Pero sí, en la película hay algunos de los que logramos capturar y hacer de nuestro equipo. Hay unos que hacen de boxeadores, otros que hacen de entrenadores, otros que salen de extras. Y ellos sí la han visto, y sí, todavía tengo relación con algunos de ellos, o como por lo menos con 4 o 5 de ellos, todavía no hemos hablado, y incluso trabajamos después en un negocio de una barra, yo necesitaba seguridad y los llamé, sí, la han visto y les gusta, Obviamente es difícil, porque a ver, nosotros terminamos de grabar y la película sale 2 años y pico después. So, hay mucha gente que se pierde en el contacto y sus vidas cambian mucho en 3 meses. Pero sí, hubo quienes la vieron y les gustó, y hubo algunos que llegaron a ir a la premiere y todo.
Deberían hacer un cine en Barranquita. Por caso, el tema es que tratamos de poner la película, bueno, primero, en Puerto Rico hay cine en casi todas partes, pero en el centro de la isla, los pueblos del centro tienen que guiar a Bayamón o a Calle, bueno, en Calle yo creo que cerraron el cine de Calle, hay que ir a cabo, o sea que realmente no hay, los pueblos del centro no tienen un cine cerca, que eso es un tema. Para la sección de comentarios de Caridad Cinema, como que hagan un Fine Arts en Orocovi, pero nosotros, por ejemplo, tratamos de llevar la película a Barranquita y nos comunicamos con el municipio, pero no se dio. Y yo me puedo entender por qué. O sea, la película no es como para ponerla gratis en la plaza con las escenitas que tiene, tú sabes. Especialmente un pueblo conservador y la escenita en el río, tú sabes. Y sí puedo entender que la película no es apta para hacer exhibiciones públicas así por el contenido que tiene. Así que pues, hacer una exhibición gratuita en Barranquita no creo que ocurra. Así gratuita públicamente. Pero sin duda, la gente de Barranquita fue al cine a ver la película, la gente ha comprado el DVD, el Blu-ray, perdón, y cada vez sigo todavía, 2 años y pico después, sigo recibiendo mensajes por Facebook de gente de Barranquita, dentro y fuera, que participaron o que viven en Estados Unidos, en el momento ven a su pueblo en la película. O sea que el acto de así tipo proyecto de comunicación pública de llevar, o Divetco, ¿no?, de llevar la pieza cinematográfica a la comunidad, pues no, es algo que quizás podemos seguir desarrollando para que pase. Pero también me imagino que es más fácil llevar una película que no tenga contenido sexual y cosas de esas que nos encantan. Sí.
Para nosotros era bien importante que se mencionara y se fuera bien claro que donde estábamos grabando era Barranquitas. Darle el nombre y apellido, sin ponerlo en pantalla, se habla de que es en Barranquitas y la gente que es de cerca de Barranquitas o de Barranquitas ven a su pueblo así como que es ahí estoy yo también, tú sabes. Para nosotros era bien importante eso.
Sí, en el caso de nosotros, como la película no lleva ni un año de haber estrenado, pues está todavía corriendo en festivales y sí nos han escrito de de Cabo Rojo, de Fajardo, de Luquillo, de Barranquitas también creo, de distintos pueblos del interior, para que para ver si podemos llevar la película a esos lugares. Y bueno, hay ciertas complicaciones técnicas que quizás Maite las puede explicar mejor, y de dinero, bueno, y todo esto de la distribución de lo que es el cine en nuestro país, porque no tenemos espacios para mostrar nuestros trabajos, o sea, es suficiente espacio para mostrar nuestro trabajo, y eso también un poco lo complica un poquitito. Por otro lado, también espacios que respeten la dedicación y el trabajo que se le ha dedicado a esa hora y media de la película, ¿no? que es trabajo de años. Sí, a la presentación oficial en Puerto Rico, la primera vez que se presentó en Puerto Rico, antes de ir a salas comerciales, habían algunos de los haitianos que salen o interpretando migrantes. También al cine llevamos a una de las señoras que fue como la que me comenzó a presentar o me introdujo a la comunidad dominicana en Río Piedra para que conversara con ellos. Ella también vio la película. Otro señor de los que entrevisté, que no sale en la película, pero de los que entrevisté, también vio la película, y algunas personas de la zona noroeste también vieron la película. Entonces fue muy lindo, ¿no? Cómo ellos se proyectan y se ven como si fuera un espejo, todo ese recorrido que ellos han hecho cuando llegaron a Puerto Rico.
Quisiera preguntarle a los dos productores que están, ahí en la lista, las dos productoras, mejor dicho. Tres preguntas muy concretas, ¿verdad? Que son
tres productoras.
Tres productores, bueno,
estás productoras.
Tres productoras.
Y él también es productor.
Y él también es productor. Sí.
Lo hacemos todo.
Primero, producir en Puerto Rico es heroico. Es muy ingrato. El que produce en Puerto Rico es porque tiene una pasión y tiene una razón mucho más allá del dinero. Segundo, ¿qué aprendí? Entonces, cuéntenos qué fue lo que los animó, ¿no?, a producir, a meterse en este trabajo tan arduo y difícil. Y la segunda pregunta es, la segunda pregunta es, después de haber pasado por el proceso de producción de estas películas, ¿qué aprendieron? Y la tercera pregunta, que es la clásica, si las películas tienen expectativas de recuperar, ¿verdad? Que yo espero que me digan que sí, porque en la medida en que así sea, se pueden hacer más películas como esta.
Si solo es expectativas, sí, es fácil.
Es que son muy nuevas, no se sabe.
Si expectativas hablamos un mamé.
Sandra.
Tres preguntitas.
Dale.
Te invito, Sandra.
Hola, pues a ver, a mí mi móvil para la película es totalmente personal y marital, porque es mi marido. Es decir, que este proceso creativamente lo empieza él, pero sí es verdad que yo soy la persona que le empuja a rellenar todos esos miles de papeles y de carpetas para poder someter la película a una convocatoria que se hace en Puerto Rico, y pues él se encarga de la parte creativa. Esa carpeta pues tuvo una funcionalidad, sirvió, ganó su convocatoria, y por ahí pues hemos ido aprendiendo en el camino. Él ya era director, pero yo no era productora. Entonces, pues realmente ha sido, en principio, el móvil fue algo pues totalmente personal. Respecto a lo que se aprende, pues imagínate, mucho. Sobre todo, la paciencia que tienen los directores y los escritores. Porque, los productores... el productor es como que más el ánimo, ¿no? Por lo menos en nuestro caso. Creo que desde que estas ideas se cuajan hasta que se ven en el cine, de verdad que es un proceso, a mí me parece... casi inhumano a veces, pero digo, ¿cómo estos muchachos y muchachas que se dedican al cine no pierden la ilusión? y es porque realmente el sueño y el arte y el talento lo ponen a funcionar. Aparte de que todos ellos han tenido que tener algo de suerte, porque sin suerte tampoco hubieran llegado a donde están. Y si se recupera, pues bueno, no se recupera, se invierte en mostrar lo que es un país. El país tiene que verse, el puertorriqueño no se quiere ver, y cuando se ve, sufre porque no está acostumbrado. Y yo creo que los gobiernos tienen que invertir definitivamente en mostrar cuál es su cultura, cuáles son los problemas sociales, los problemas políticos, y eso es parte de la educación de un país.